So we're not squinting. We should be live. Sound should be coming through. Last time we had a little bit of problem with the sound. Good afternoon, everyone. How are you doing? I hope you're doing well. June 30th. Round of 16 of the World Cup. Did you guys catch any of the games? I've been out of the World Cup loop for couple of World Cups now, but I was pretty avid with it before 2010, and I'm back into it again. Wow, amazing games. Hello, Frank. How are you doing? I hope you're doing well. Nice Saturday afternoon, my part anyway. It's going to be late evening, basically midnight UK time. Europe, you guys are the middle of the night now, I guess. 1 o'clock in the morning. I won't be starting any streams in the mornings my time here because I'm watching the World Cup and loving it. Two of the best games I've ever seen in my life were played today. They were fantastic. I hope you guys are watching them. Welcome to another live stream. So we're just gonna chill for about 5-10 minutes. Hello, Dan. Luisa Dan 92. How are you doing? I don't recognize your name. Is this your first stream? Maybe. I'm assuming the sound is coming out okay. How are we doing for time? We're a couple of minutes in, and we're gonna do a comic book haul today. And the comic book haul is gonna be it's been sitting here for a few days now. It got here early and I was trying to gather up some data because I'm going to present some data in this live stream regarding this comic book haul. Yes, it is. Okay, it is your first stream. Welcome to a Chicho live stream. Fun. So basically, I'm going to be popping up some charts. Hey, JD, how are you doing? JD Tuck, I don't recognize your name either. We got some new people here. Cool. Welcome to a live stream. Welcome to a comic book live stream. Linking it up with mathematics and investing, which should be fun. I got a couple of graphs for you too, charts that I want to show you guys. Okay. But I'll pop all that stuff when we start doing it. And let me give you a lay of the land. That's what I've been doing usually when we're doing these shoots. And basically, we're into the second phase of introducing live streaming into the repertoire of what we're going to do. And this is basically the third video that we're doing, which is shooting on an HD camera, recording on a lapel mic, right? And we're going to do that using... Hello, David. How are you doing? Welcome. And this is the angle we're going to use, this one, when I'm going to show you guys the live stream. And I have a whole bunch of charts that are going to be popping up here, like tables and charts and stuff. And I'm basically going to show you the comic books here. Okay. But until we get going, and that's the basically same angle. I got a sort of an external camera set up showing here for the live stream, and the HD camera sitting on top. I could do this actually. Let me show it to you. Because one of the reasons I'm doing this is because I want people to know what it is that I'm doing. Hopefully I'm not gonna mess anything up. You see the two cameras here? This one is the live stream one that we're gonna see, and this one is the HD camera that we're recording on, okay? And there's a mic here. I'm not gonna rotate it anymore, the laptop. And there's, I have my live stream mic set up here, and that's what you're hearing the sound from. And the lapel mic is going to record onto a recorder where we're going to, you know, overlay it with the video with the HD camera and edit stuff. Okay. And Angered, hello, welcome back. And thank you for the Twitch Prime sub. Awesome. Hey, Chicho, it's been a little while. Hey, Faskar, how are you doing? Yeah, I got busy with the school year, right, with the students and stuff and organizing and just taking a little breather. I needed a few days of a little breather Always a pleasure. Thanks, Ingrid. Taking a few days breather and recouping and sort of doing certain things on the back end and trying to figure out how we're going to roll all this into play, right? It's definitely challenging. It's definitely fun. The learning process has been amazing for me, guys. I'm loving this, right? Totally loving it. Doing good, man. School is done, so I'm just taking life easy. Awesome. That's good, man. Congrats finishing it. Congrats finishing it, man. It's a huge load off, right? What a breather. You're out of jail. Now you can decide on what you want to do with the tools, the information that you require. And there's a lot more coming, of course, right? Basically, as far as I'm concerned, education, the first role of education should really be to teach people how to teach themselves, right? That should be the first goal of education. Unfortunately, that's not the way it's set up for elementary and high school anyway. Post-secondary, you're on your own too, for the most part anyway, for the most part anyway. Okay, so we're about 6 minutes in, gang. Should we give people a little bit more time to pop in? I think we should start the comic McCall. I've been waiting to crack this thing open for like, I don't know how many days now, like 5 days now, right? I had a hard time finding one of the websites that contained a lot of information that I was looking for, right? So just so you know, all the tables and the charts, well, one of the charts I ended up making, but the tables, the data that I'm going to present in this comic book haul video, I'm going to provide links in the description of the video once we load it onto BitChute, YouTube, and wherever it's going, right? So there'll be links directing you to this, basically the data that we're going to present in this comic book haul video. And we're definitely going to take a look at the covers, and I'm going to give you a little bit of history regarding this, right? Because this comic book haul is Valiant's. Okay, so before we get going, I gotta set myself up with my external mic. Let me set this up. I get myself sort of boxed in when I'm doing these videos, so I have to sort of move a little slow just to make sure I'm not gonna topple anything over. Let me turn this on, and I need to put tape on this guy because it's been with me for a while, so to make the connection better, I need to have this on here. I have to sort of give it a little bit of pull. I'm not sure how much longer this will last, but for now it's doing okay. We'll take it, right? This is all I do, right? Put a little tape over the thing, and whenever I do tape, I sort of do a little like this so it's easier to pull off, right? And I do too, and I go under it as well. Go around, right? Go around under it. The batteries should be good. Fingers crossed. Famous last words, right? Let's do this. I'm gonna change the angle. I'm gonna do a little bit of movement. Saw poor condition Action Comics 1 go for around $150,000 on eBay recently. Nice. You know what? When it comes down to it, assuming that the population of the planet is going to grow, assuming that history is going to repeat itself, human artifacts are collectibles, and Action Comics number one is a collectible. If I had $150,000 just laying around, I had all the equipment I needed, everything, home bought and paid for, and I didn't have any debt or anything like this. At 150,000, let's see, I had $200,000 sitting on the side. I would not be holding on to the cash. Well, right now maybe, because we're in bubble everything, right? So you do need a little bit of cash. Since this comic book haul is going to talk about investment, so I'm going to get into this a little bit. Since in bubble times, you want to hold on to cash because when prices collapse, you need, you can buy things up. But if you have extra money, human artifacts, art, is worth investing in for multiple reasons. One of them is because it's collectible, it's a rarity. The other one is our current economic system is based on laundering money, so there's a lot of money being laundered through art, through human artifacts, through collectibles, right? So unless that changes, then investing in art is a good idea. Hello, Double Elvis. What's up, Chicho? It's been a while since I've caught you live. Been super busy during the summer. Hope you're doing well. I'm doing well, brother. Thank you very much. Now that school season's ended and I got a comic book haul right now, I'm super happy. Super happy. Okay. So guys, I'm gonna change the angle. And the odds are I'm not gonna read comments. I might if I need to take a little break, if I need to gather my thoughts or something. The odds are I'm not gonna read comments while we're doing the video shoot. But when we finish the video shoot, you know, once I stop the DVD or HD camera or whatever and stop recording on this guy, we'll come back and we'll continue our discussion if you guys want to talk or anything like this. What do you call it? We'll continue the conversation for a little bit longer anyway, okay? So let me change the angle, camera angle view, and I need to do a little adjustment. So let me do a little adjustment first. I'm gonna bring, I don't want this to be too loud. Let me move this guy back. Let me take this guy off. This guy. Let me take this off so I'm not getting dizzy. I need to bring this. Because I'm going to control the mouse from bringing the comic book haul here. Bring my mouse here, right? So let's change the camera angle view. I gotta squint a little bit. And this is the camera angle view we're gonna use. Okay. Let me make sure I'm set up here. I'm not tangled. Okay. I'm gonna turn on the recorder. Where are we? There you are. So that's on. Turn on the sound. Test. What's this on? I'm gonna turn this on too. Test. 1, 2, 3. So that's on. Now I need to put this somewhere where I'm not gonna trip over it. I am test. And I need to, with this thing, I usually put it somewhere where I can actually take a look at it. Make sure, oh, I should be talking here. Sorry, gang. Take a look at it and make sure it's recording, right? You can see this. See that bars going over it, right? Every now and then I glance at it just to make sure it's recording because it's got multiple batteries going and stuff like this. So let's put this guy here. Okay, let's tape one of the cords over. Here. My feet aren't gonna trip over it. Now we're gonna do a little clap. Test. 1, 2, 3. I need to have a time stamp for the sound and the video being recorded, right? Let me make sure this thing is not hitting anything. I usually have a little mirror with me just to check, make sure the lapel mic is not sitting on my shirt, so it's not going to be scraping sound. Okay. Sorry about the loudness. Oops, sorry about the loudness, gang. Okay, so let me position myself where I'm gonna. Percentages, I need to make this a little bit bigger and make this a little bit wider so we can see what's going on. Okay. everyone, this is Chicho. Welcome to my channel. Now what we're gonna do in this video is do another comic book haul. Okay, and I'm sort of excited for this comic book haul because it's all the books are from a publisher that I love, right? Valiant Comics, right? So this is purely a Valiant comic book haul, and this box arrived about 5 days ago, 6 days ago, and usually when I get a comic book haul, I usually crack it open right away. Even, you know, if we're making videos or if we're not making videos, I usually crack it open right away and check the comics. That way I can leave feedback for the seller, right? But what I was going to do for this, and what I am going to do, and what we are going to do for this, is link up this comic book haul with the work that we've been doing in ASMR math regarding investing in comic books, right? Where we're gonna link up some of the data that we're gonna collect through this genre, through collecting comic books, and do a little mathematics on it, and basically learn what it means to invest in something, what the rate of return might be and whatnot, right? So when I went to collect all the data, because the package arrived a little earlier than expected, right? It arrived like really fast because I bought this comic book haul from a BC resident, right? I think it was Alberta coming to me, right? So it came to me super fast. It's within Canada. And when I went to put the data together, one of the websites, one of the pages that I was using to find the print runs for some of the comics in this lot was dead. So what I had to do was go to archive.org and for that site, and basically go back a couple of years and start clicking on pages to see if I could find them. And after a couple of days search, I actually found the data. So what I want to do is, you know, do a little intro before we crack this thing open, okay? Because the data for this haul is important, okay? And if you're a Valiant comic book fan, if you know the history of Valiant Comics, you might appreciate what we're about to do and what we're about to look at, and you're gonna love these comic books. Okay, so what I want to do right now is bring up a couple of images. One of them is a table and another one is a chart. And just so you know, we're actually live streaming this comic book haul as well, right? So while I'm recording this, and I'm going to edit this video with the sound and overlay it with the video with the HD camera and stuff, there's a bunch of people watching this live as well. So what I'm going to do is do a little bit of looking over here and make sure I'm popping up the right images for the people that are going to be watching this live, okay? So before we crack this open, let me show you the data that we have for Valiant Comics from the 1990s. And Valiant Comics is a company that came to be in, they started off basically doing comic books in 1990s. And what you see here right now is we have a chart here for Valiant Comics. And I have the charts here as well. So I'm gonna show you, this is what I'm looking at, and that should be what you're looking at as well, right? So Valiant Comics came to be basically in the 1990s, and 1991 basically they kicked off their superhero, their universe building. Before that they were doing some comic book publishing with Nintendo, you know, Mario Brothers, Zelda and stuff like this, gaming comic books, right? But in 1991 basically they kicked off their universe, right? So what you see here basically with this chart up top here is the print run for Valiant Comics from 1991 to 1996, right? And Valiant Comics, when they came onto the scene, the two main people that put Valiant Comics together were Jim Shooter and Bob Layton. Jim Shooter and Bob Layton came in through Marvel Comics. Jim Shooter was actually Marvel's editor-in-chief for the third longest period. He was Marvel's editor-in-chief for like 12 years. So he came in, and he was doing comics books before that. So both Bob Layton and Jim Shooter came in with a tremendous amount of experience, Jim Shooter specifically, right? And he started in Valiant Comics because he got some investors together. They had a failed bid to buy Marvel Comics, right? So his vision was grand, right? And this is sort of the print run of the comic books, the chart here that they produced from 1991 all the way to 1996, right? So when they came onto the scene, basically the first couple of titles that they released were Magnus Robot Fighter and Solar Man of the Atom, right? And they were Golden Age characters that they bought the rights for, not bought the characters all that, but they bought the rights for it to create comics with those characters in them, right? So what you see basically is the print run from 1991 to 1992, right? Those are the low period where you see here, right? And if you take a look at the table below this, what you're going to see is the percent of basically for each year, what the total percent of the comics that Valiant Comics in the first go at entering the comic book industry, how many comic books they printed for each year. And what you can do, you basically sort of the era, I sort of broke it down into pre-Unity, Unity, post-Unity, post-Unity bubble, because it wasn't just Valiant Comics that had a bubble in the mid-1990s, it was a whole industry. And then what we have in the mid-1990s bubble and the bubble bursting and the ending of the first go of Valiant Comics, right? For this comic book haul, what we're about to do, majority of these comic books, a huge percentage of them, are from the pre-Unity Valiant Comics, and there's a bunch of comics in the tail end from 1996, right? 1995, 1996. I believe it's mainly 1996, right? So there's a handful of these comic books in this comic book haul, majority of them anyway, are from the early period pre-Unity Valiant Comics and from the later years, from 1996 Valiant Comics, where the print runs really went down, right? And that's really important because once there is, the print runs for certain books are less, they become harder to find, rarer, and their prices usually kick up. The harder the book is to find, the more expensive the book ends up being, right? And the table I really like there, where it shows you basically 1993, right? The total number of comic books, right? Issues that Valiant Comics printed from 1991 to 1996, you can see it in that table there, right? Was around 81 million comic books, right? Issues. And 50% of those were published in 1993, right? That's what you call huge growth. Now, the comic book industry went through a serious bubble phase and burst, and it wasn't, due to Valiant Comics specifically. It was the industry doing it. There was a lot of business decisions being made by the big two, Marvel and DC, and the distributors. Like pre-Unity, before the mid-1990s, right? Before basically in 1994, by 1994, there was basically 12 distributors. There were two main distributors of comic books, and there was like 10 other secondary distributors, and there was like tertiary distributors of comic books, right? After the bubble burst, after the mid-1990s, basically all the distributors, most of them went bankrupt, and it basically came down to one comic book distributor, and that's Diamond Comic Distributors, that sends their comic books to comic book stores. So any comic book store that wants to buy comic books has to buy it through Diamond Distributors, right? That's what happened with the industry. Right now, things are changing up a little bit with digital comics, and recently, I believe DC Comics cut a deal with Walmart where they're making exclusively Walmart comic books and whatnot, right? So you really have to take what was going on in the 1990s into context when we're taking a look at this comic book haul, okay? And just to show you a little bit of data, and by the way, all this information that I'm going to be presenting to you, right, that's going to pop up with tables and charts and stuff before we look at these comic books, right? I'm going to provide links in the description of this video. So if you want to follow some of this data and take a look at some additional data, you have the links there. And we're definitely going to do a little bit of work on this stuff and take a look at what it means to invest in something, specifically what we're talking about, investing in comic books, right? Or investing in art, human artifacts, collectibles. And basically, if you follow some of the stuff we've done with personal finance and economics, this is basically money, right? Not currency, but money. That's the way I look at it, right? So keep this chart in mind. I might pop this up again during our comic book haul, right? And one other thing I want to show you that I will provide a link in the description of this video, is what you see here in this table is 17 of the rarest comic books, pre-Unity comic books. If you remember that chart here, let me bring up this chart again one more time. One thing I want to point out to you, let me take this table away. We'll bring the table again, but let me show you this chart. If you take a look at this chart, in mid-1992, right, there was a crossover event that Valiant Comics did, and that was, in according to this chart, was July. Let me bring up the table too so you actually can see what it is. That was in July 1992, and the event, crossover event that went across all their titles, was called Unity. It was a magnificent crossover. It's one of the greatest crossovers in comic book history. Okay, once that crossover happened, Valiant Comics, the sales just kicked up huge, because it was one of the most, it was extremely tight story told. It was fantastic, right? But what you're going to see in the next table, that, let me take these charts down, and this table that you see here, this is Valiant's rarest regular issues pre-Unity. So this is the 17 rarest issues pre-July 1992, right? And in this comic book haul, we have 8 of these issues in this comic book haul, and we actually have copies of all 5 of the top 5. Okay, just letting you know this. And basically their print runs, with the rarest one being Rye number 3 and Rye number 4, there were 35,000 copies printed. And the 17th one would be Magnus number 12, which was the first appearance of Torak, Dinosaur Hunter, which is another gold key character that Valiant bought the rights for, which is 50,000 issues. And then after that, there's a whole bunch of other titles which have similar to 50, 60, 70, 80,000. There was very, very few that went over 80,000 until we go past the Unity era, right? Past mid-1992, right? And right now, at present, comic books that are being published, they have, you know, if they have 35,000 print run, they're doing good, right? There's a lot of comic books being published right now that have 10,000 or less print run. But during the time in the 1990s, 35,000 issues wasn't that much, right? There was a lot of comic books that were having, you know, 80,000, 100,000 print runs. Some of them were into the hundreds of thousands of print runs, right? Hundreds of thousands of copies being printed. So keep this chart in mind. This is 17 of the rarest pre-Unity Valiant comic books from the 1990s, and we have 8 of those comics in this haul. Okay, and they're fantastic, and they're fantastic. Now, since I've given you a little background on this, while we crack open this box, let me bring up the table. Let me show you what we bought. Okay, let me take the table down for those watching live, and let me bring up the haul. And we're going to bring out, while you take a look at the haul, we'll go over it for sure. I'm not sure if the seller has packaged these things up according to each haul. There's a couple of buys that I did which are basically more recent comic books, but 4 of those hauls, which are Solar, Harbinger, and 2 Rye hauls, they're pre-Unity hauls, most of them anyway. There's some that are for the graph, hopefully the chart, if you see the chart here, that's the percentages, we don't want that one. If you see that, and there's some at the tail end in 1996 that the print runs are very, very few. Okay, and I'll show you a table with the print runs of the books that we have. So let me crack this open. I hope the books aren't damaged. I usually don't let a box sit like this for this long, right? But we'll bring out our Bloodshot box cutter. I've used this a lot, right? It's a little dull, but it should do the job for us. Right, take a look. This is it. This is all we got. Which isn't bad. It's 52 comics, right? Just so you know, another bit of info I'll give you is when I was looking for the data to put all the information that I showed you and a little bit more that's coming up, I went to a Valiant forum and I posted a question saying, because I was trying to find a page that had all this information, the print one specifically, right? And I couldn't find it, so I was in like, oh man, I can't believe we lost that data, right? I checked out a lot of things and I went to a forum and asked the question if anybody had that information, right? And I posted some of the information of what I ended up buying, and that's the print runs I was looking for. And someone came up there and said, hey, wait a second, I just sold those comics on eBay. You must have been the buyer. So I was like, oh, dude, yeah, thank you very much for putting these up. And I mentioned to him that who I was and what I was about to do. And he was really psyched that we're about to do a comic book haul and go through this information, because he's a Valiant fan as well. Nicely packaged. Take a look at this. All right, nicely packaged. Oops. Here we go. All right. So let me take this down and we'll bring it up the hull. Where is my hull? Let me bring this down. That's. Take a look at this stuff. Oh, everything's together. Look at this. I don't think he organized them according to the halls. He might not have. Look at that. Nice. 51 comics. All Valiants. Let's take a look. Oh, this stuff has got like, seriously wrapped up. Look at this. The packing tape on it. It's insane. Unfortunately, wow, it's Harbinger number. Take a look at this. He's got one comic book facing out with the bubble wrap. You should have flipped that, but that's okay. But that's Harbinger number 14, I believe. He did a good job packaging it. Very tight. Very tight. Yes. Nice. Look at all that. Look at the Greg Rabbit. Dangerous. It's basically 51 loose comic books, right? Okay. Nice. Did he package them together? Oh, he might have. Take a look at this. Sweet. So he packaged them together, right? This is Ninjak. Okay, let me put these guys here. Make sure we're not going to drop any. Awesome. Okay, I'm gonna show them to you. Okay, let's start off with this guy. Let me set myself up properly so we're not gonna be damaging anything. Nothing lay on top of each other. Okay. Take a look at this. This guy is Valiant Masters Ninjak hardcover. Okay. And This baby is the reprints Valiant Comics, right? So let me bring up the table, the chart. You'll see it here. Da-da-da-da-da. Charts, chart, right there. This guy reprints. Hopefully you'll see it. It's not too small. But if you take a look at the chart in January 1994, right? So let me bring up the table as well. Percentages. So January 1994, you see a little peak. It's on the come down of the graph, right? There's Ninjak number one, okay? And this is a collection of the first six issues. So let me take the chart down, the percentages down, right? This is reprint of the first six issues of Ninjak, okay? The first Ninjak series that came out. It also includes Ninjak Zero and Ninjak Double Zero, right? And I actually, for Valiant Comics, I've mentioned this before, but when Jim Shooter was ousted from Valiant Comics, I didn't last much longer. I bought Turok number one, I believe was the last comic that I bought. And if you take a look at the chart, Turok number one, is the peak there. The peak of sort of this is almost like a normal distribution, right? So the peak of the graph that you see, that's Turok number one. I basically, that was, I believe, the last issue that I bought off the shelf, right? And this thing is beautiful shape. The guy who was selling this, he didn't really list. This was sort of shot in the dark. He didn't give a grade for these books. He said they were nice books, right? The only one he said was the Solar lot that we bought. And he mentioned that the Solar lot, the first few issues, had been read a few times and rightfully so. They're some of the best comic books ever printed, period. The first 10 issues of Solar Man of the Atom from Valiant Comics from the 1990s, that's 10 of the greatest comic books ever printed. Like, really fantastic storytelling, right? But let me bring up the haul again. Let's bring up the haul. Look at the charts. Hi, X. How are you doing? So this is, where is my haul? This is the first package there that you see up top. It's Valiant Masters Ninjak hardcover, okay? And it came out in 2013. He had listed everything. All of these lots were listed as buy it now, and I sent them offers. So he had listed it for 15 Canadian, by the way. These are Canadian prices. The only US prices you'll see is in the totals, right? So $15 Canadian, he had listed it, and I paid 10, I offered him $10 Canadian, right? And he accepted. So that was 33% less, and I put the percentages there as well. 33% less than what he was asking, right? Beautiful copy, right? And let me show you something else here. I made a chart, right? Or not a chart, a table of the print runs of some of the key issues in this haul, or most of the issues in this haul. I missed a couple of them, right? So here's a table with the print runs. This guy that you see here, Ninjak hardcover, is the top one listed right up here, right? And according to the website that has all the print run information, and I know a lot of the pre-Unity stuff is valid because I was buying Valiant Comics back then, and I seeked out as much information as I could. So I know the early Valiant, their print runs are legit. I don't know about this one, but according to the table that they put together, this guy only has 1,500 print run. There's only 1,500 of these printed, and I bought this baby for $10, and it's in beautiful condition. Take a look at this. Right, let me take this table down again. Doop. Take a look at this. Just beautiful. Right? Fantastic. Thank you very much for putting this out. And I haven't read this. So this I'm going to read. I haven't read the first issues of Ninjak. You believe it? Very happy to have this. Okay, I'm gonna put this guy here. Nice, nice. So let's take a look at another one. Okay, since we mentioned solar, let's bring out the solar books. Nice. Take a look at this. He's got it listed here, what's contained in this, right? Let me bring up the table. Okay. This guy. So in this package, right? This one is the third one down the chart. Okay. It's solar man of the atom set, right? It has solar number one, number four, number five, number six, number seven, number eight. It's got number, it actually should have number 11 here as well, but he hasn't listed it on this. So it should have number 11. It's got number 56, number 57, two copies of number 57, two copies of number 58, and one copy of 59. And those are the later issues. And I'll bring up as soon as we take a look at this. Okay. And by the way, he was asking $46 for this lot, and I offered him 30, and that was 35% less. And there's 16 books here, and he accepted the offer. Right? So let me take this down. Let me take down the hall. Boop. And let's open this. I don't want to do any damage to these, because I'm going to show you. He's got them two to a bag. Masking tape is not the best for it. Seals everything really tight, but that was serious business. Take a look at this. And he mentioned, the only thing he mentioned, this is solar number one. Take a look, right? Beautiful, beautiful. Barry Windsor Smith, right? And in the description, solar is the only one where he said the early issues have been read a lot. And these look to be in really good shape. And this is solar number four, right? So this lot we got for $30, everything we're going to take a look at right now, right? Solar number one, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Solar number four, should we crack this open? I want to see what his idea of being read a lot means, right? Get rid of the tape because I don't want it to snag on anything. Let's throw that baby there. Let's take a look at this. That's not I was expecting these to be much worse. Really, when he said he spent a rat a lot. Not bad, not bad at all. So I would give this. Let me put on my glasses. Let me put on my glasses. So I would give this guy a grade of. At least an 8.5, at least. That is awesome. Okay, let me show you a few pages of this because it's just beautiful. Just beautiful. Right? this should be on our reading list. We should really be reading Solar as well. Take a look. That's the cover, right? Here's the first page. Beautiful. And what it says is, let's see why I am here. Wonder what happened to my clothes. I'm usually careful about my clothes. So what you see here is there's the earth and there's Solar up top there, falling, going to the earth, not falling, I guess flying towards the earth. Second death, part one, no place like home. And the color for Valiant Comics from the 1990s was beautiful. The coloring on it, right? Beautiful, beautiful. Oh well, somebody move Moskagi. Take a look at this. Okay, we won't read anymore because it's fantastic. Okay. And the writer for this, and Valiant Comics at the time, they put their who was writing and editing on the last page at the bottom here of each issue. So this is written by Jim Shooter, pencils by David Perlim, ink and editor Bob Layton, colorist Catherine Bulger, letterer Jade. Oh, I guess the cover is not Barry Windsor Smith. I'm surprised. I always thought it was Barry Windsor Smith. Is it? It must be. Is there a signature of Barry Windsor Smith? Barry Windsor Smith usually signs it that BWS. Oh, it is Barry Windsor Smith. Take a look. Right there. BWS, Barry Windsor Smith, right? So the covers of these, I believe, they're all Barry Windsor Smith. Okay. So I'm gonna throw this back in the back and we're gonna take a look at the rest of the covers. And then I'm gonna rebag all this. Actually, I'm just gonna put this up top here. I don't wanna do any damage to it. And if that is considered to be read a lot, this guy took care of his comic books. Thank you very much, brother. Thank you very much. Okay, this is gonna be loud again as well, so my apologies. I'm gonna do it gently. Okay, let me do it gently. Okay, we don't need to take the whole thing off the back. Please do this, lock it up so it doesn't damage anything. This is Solar number 5. Again, Barry Windsor Smith. Let me show you this. There's Barry Windsor Smith, Solar number 5. Right. And this is about the same shape as Solar number 1, so 8.5. I was happy with 6s on these, really. And you can get these on the cheap. Number 6. Right, so we took a look at Solar number 1, number 4, right? Before I do this, let me show you. Actually, I'll show you 7 and 8 as well, and then I'll show you what the print runs of these is, right? So this is Solar number 5. Beautiful, beautiful cover, beautiful cover. Right. Solar number 6, this is a version of the Exo armor. Less powerful. Solar number 7. Just beautiful. These belong on the wall. These belong on the wall. All Barry Windsor Smith covers. Solar number 8. Is this still Barry Windsor Smith? No, it's not. It looks like it's Don Pearl and Stan Drake did the cover for number 8. Here's Solar number 11. Okay. And this is the second appearance of the Eternal Warrior, and he's the guy there. Okay. And his It's his first appearance, first cover appearance, right? Solar number 10 is the first appearance, is a black cover of the Eternal Warrior, and this is solar number 11, second appearance, and the first appearance on the cover. Okay. Here's solar number 14, and from this solar number 14, this thing is common. There's a lot of this printed. Okay. And we'll take a look at the table with the print runs. There should be a couple more. Oh, he had solar 42 in here. Oh, there it is. 23. Here's solar 23. Okay. And I kept on reading solar. I have this issue as well. And this is when solar splits into Dr. Eclipse. I can't remember what the name of that guy is. He has a, I think it's this issue. He has a sort of a nervous breakdown. He has a, he falls apart, right? And this is what happens when a super being falls apart. They shed off their secondary persona, right? This is solar number 42. Okay. I didn't know 42 was in this one. He has some of these ones that are common on top of each other, so I can read the number on it. These guys, the later issues of Solar, let me, while I, because these guys are all together, so I'm gonna crack these open, show you the covers. I don't know which ones those are. Those are, I'm assuming, is 56, 57, and 58. But let me show you this. All print runs. This is the print run of the Solars we've gotten. And I put these things on top of here, so let me grab this paper. Okay, so just so you know, Solar number 1 had a print run of 60,000, Solar number 4, 60,000, number 5 and number 6, 55,000, number 7 that we saw was 45 to 50,000, number 8 was 40,000, number 11 was 85,000, okay, because it started kicking off then. And then these later comics that we're about to see, this is Solar number 56, right? And in the table you'll see that solar number 56 had 25,000 print run. Very rare if it was a pre-unity, but later on it wasn't. Let's take this masking tape, throw it there, or scotch tape. Let's take a look at this. Nice. He actually said these later issues were beautiful copies, and they look like to be very, very beautiful copies. I need a heart. Here, let me put this. This is number 56, right? Oops, let me put the table down so you see. So number 56, let me give you the print runs for this. Number 56 is 25,000. 57 is, number 56 is 25,000. 57 and 58 are 21,000. And 59 is 17,000 printed, right? Wow, wow, wow. Not very many, not very many. 56. I haven't read these ones. Right? These are beautiful copies. Look at that. 57 again, two copies. I wish I brought bags and boards here so I could bag and board them right now, because they're sitting loose. Nice copies. 58, right? Here's another copy of 58. Nice. And here's 59. Okay. And this is the second to last issue. There's a 50, there's a 60, right? And I don't have the number 60. And these later issues go for a premium price. Number 60 goes for a premium price. Okay, nice cover. Look at that. solar, man of the atom. I'm sort of slowly, what I'm trying to do is, for the Valiant comics anyway, is be a completionist and basically put all the runs together. It's going to be hard to do for some of them, because some of them were, the print runs were very, very, very little, right? Especially when it came to, I believe, Bloodshot. We have the print runs for those. Let me put this guy here. I'll remember to pick those up, right? So as far as the table, the Rarest Valiants, let me show you this as well. Rarest Valiants, where is that? Rarest 17. So for the Solars that we just took a look at, right? Solar number 8 is the 12th rarest pre-unit Valiant, which we just grabbed in this lot. And Solar number 7 is the 15th rarest Valiant, pre-unity Valiant, right? And we grabbed one in this lot as well, and they're pretty good copies. They're not bad. I would rate them around 8, 8.5. A couple of them look like to be 9. I would have to take a closer look to look at them, right? So that's fantastic. I'm very happy about that. Very, very happy about that. Okay, let's grab here. Let me put the Solars away, so they're not gonna get damaged. Okay, let's put these guys here. And what should we grab? Let's take a look at Harbinger. Let's take a look at Harbinger. Right. So let me take down Rarest. By the way, since we have the Rarest up here in this lot, okay, we have a Harbinger number 4 and Harbinger number 4. And it has the coupon in it. I asked them before I bid on this, right? Harbinger number 4 is the 5th rarest pre-unity Valiant, right? With 35 to 40,000 copies. And this thing used to go for a premium price back in the day. Oops, let me take down the table. So that's the only Harbinger. Actually, Harbinger number 1 is in that list as well. It's number 16. Oh, hold on a second. Harbinger number 3 and 4. Check this out. So Harbinger number 3, 4, 3, 5, right? And Harbinger number 2, 6, and Harbinger number 1 are all in the top 17 rarest pre-unity Valiants, right? We just ended up getting Harbinger number 4 in this lot. We didn't get Harbinger 1, 2, 3, 5, or 6. Okay, but I have those in my collection, and they're beautiful copies. They're beautiful copies. But I was very happy to get this. As far as what this lot cost, oh my, oh my. This lot. Check this out. This is the 4th one in the list. He listed it for $16.95 Canadian. I offered him 12, right? I was limited on my funds, right? I was slowly been putting money in, on the side to do comic book hauls, right? I was limited on my funds and I wanted to grab all these. So I gave him offers of something I could afford, right? And if he counter offered, I left a little bit of buffer for myself to counter, you know, take his counter offer. But he didn't counter offer, he just took all the offers. I offered him $12 Canadian. So that's 25, 29% less, right? So $12 Canadian, multiply that by 0.76, you get it in US funds, right? So I got this for $12 Canadian. Okay, let's crack these open. And he's got the tape on there too, so I gotta be a little bit gentle with this. It's unfortunate that he put the tape on top of Harbinger number 4. Oh, he's got a tape down here as well. Let's take a look. Okay. Oh man, there's tape here. So let me take this down, because we're gonna start taking a look at these guys. That should do it. And actually, this lot also has Harbinger number 5 in it as well. So we also got the 7th rarest Valiant comic. So let me show you these ones. Those are 2 to a bag. That's fine. Here's. That's fine. And. Okay, I gotta pull this out to freedom. And he sent me pictures of Harbinger number 4 with the coupon in it, right? Because what Harbinger did, Valiant did for Harbinger, they basically for the first 8 issues, I believe it's 8 issues of Harbinger, they included, it could have been 6, I think it's 8 though. For the first 8 issues of Harbinger, they included a coupon in the books where you could collect all 8 issues. I'm not gonna tear this guy off. Okay, but basically this is Harbinger. Two times 9, number 4, number 5, number 11, number 12, number 14, two of them, number 15, one, and number 12, one, right? And number 15 is the first appearance of Livewire, which is a major character, right? So this is Harbinger number 4. Should we crack it open to see if the coupon's in there? Let's crack it open. I'm curious to see what the condition is on it as well. Let's see. Because he didn't say what the conditions on these were. Not bad. Not bad at all. Not bad at all. Look at that. Sharp corners. Again, like an 8.5. Oh, there's a little thing here. Maybe an 8? Still a good buy. You can get these on the cheap. Where the love light gleams. Awesome. Awesome coloring. Let's go to the center, make sure we got the coupon. And here's the coupon. Take a look. I think for Magnus, the coupon was in the center. Nice. Take a look at the letters page. Take a look at this. Look at that. Very nice. Valiant had some amazing fans back in the 90s. They did a lot of promo work, and people would dress up as Valiant characters, and they would give away a lot of freebies to their fans. They did a fantastic job marketing Valiant. Really, they did an amazing job marketing Valiant. They had to, you know, serious respect must be given to them for that. They treated their readers with respect. When the industry was seeing some hard times. Okay, and here's Harbinger number 5. And I hope this has the coupon in there as well. I'm assuming it probably does. Should we crack it open and take a look? Let's crack it open and take a look. Must be done. Must be done. Shape is this guy in? This is a nice copy, very nice copy. Little bit of ding in the corner, or a little bit of fold mark. Let's check it out. Doesn't look like number 5. Oh, it does have the coupon. Take a look. Nice. Awesome. Really good. Story of Harada. And this is good. When you have this, you can read the story of Harada, his origin, on the cards themselves. Right? Here, let me show it to you. Take a look. This. This is a nice copy. This is a 9 at least. 8.5. That guy right there. Right. You put the coupons together and you can read the story of Harada. Awesome. 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 With the coupon. $12 Canadian. And the Solars, later issues. Fantastic. Not Solar, sorry. Yeah, those are Solars later issues. The Harbinger doesn't happen. I'm getting too excited, right? And this is the first appearance of Livewire. This guy right here, number 15. And Livewire is one of the main characters in the Valiant universe. Okay. Let's put these guys away. Let's put these guys away where they won't get damaged. Very nice. Very happy with that buy. Very happy with that buy. So let's take a look. What else are we gonna crack open? Let me show you. Let's hit up Post Unity or Post the relaunch of Valiant from 2012, right? Because the Masterworks, the trade paperback, is a relaunch of Valiant, the new company, not the new company, it's Valiant still, but the takeover, revamping with new people in there. And this title that we're gonna see here, this is Ninjak. This is Ninjak, the first issue of Ninjak, right? From the relaunch. And this came out in 2013, I believe. It was 2012. I can't remember when it came out, what year. I don't think it was 2012. 2012 was Harbinger and EXO. They kicked off the relaunch of Valiant. But I think it was 2013. It might have been 2014. Okay, and the Masters Edition was the first 6 issues of Valiant, of Ninjak from the 1990s, right? Let me put up the table so you know what we ended up getting here. Where's our haul? There it is, haul. So this one is the second one in the table, and it's Ninjak number 1, number 5 to 8, number 12, number 13, and number 24. And there's 3 copies of number 5. And number 5 is I guess it'd be third or fourth appearance of Roku. Roku's in there. And Ninjak number 1 is the first appearance of Roku. That's another female character from the Valiant universe that is very popular, right? And it's a great character, really. I wish this had Ninjak number 4 in there as well, with the Roku cover, the pink Roku cover. That one's fetching a premium price. I do have copies, but that one, man, these tapes are hard to get off. Whenever, anybody's listening, if you're packing comics to send to people, never use this tape, right? This tape is just grabs onto the plastic. It's very difficult to pull off. Like this tape here. It's no good. Let's throw that. So difficult. Like, nice. This is number 24. Beautiful cover. Let me show you these covers. And basically, for this lot, he was asking $24. And from the pictures, they look like they were like per beautiful shape, right? He was asking $25. I offered him 15, and he accepted, which was fantastic. There's two in a bag here. Let me take this off. This lot has number 18.
14 bullets.
Here, let me show you this. Let me pull this out. This is Ninjak number one. Sorry, Ninjak number five. All five copies in one bag. That's a little too tight. Big, like, that's a little too tight to put in there. Shouldn't put three copies in one bag. Two copies doable, three copies not so much. It's okay though. So here's Ninjak number five, right? That's Roku right there. Okay. And number four had the origin of Roku, which was a fantastic issue. Really, it was a great read. Basically, so there's three copies of number five. Like Ninjak number four was a great issue. Okay. And the pink cover. Oh, I gotta take the table down. My bad. For the hall. For the live stream. Sorry, gang. Here's Ninjak number five. Right? That way you can see it. Okay. And three copies of it. Right? But Ninjak number four with the Roku cover, where she's just standing there, pink, guns drawn. Beautiful cover, and that one seriously fetches a premium price. It was sold out basically as soon as it hit the shelves when it first came out. And here's Roku again. This is Ninjak number one. So this is variant cover. Here's two copies of Ninjak number one. That's the most common copy. Okay, I think that's cover A. And here's Ninjak number one, cover B, and Roku is right there. And Ninjak number one is the first appearance of Roku. Okay. Here's this cover I love. Really, I love this cover. Here's, well, I'll show you the cover that I love first. Ninjak number seven. This is one of the bad guys that they get together or they do a team. I have, well, we'll leave it there. Okay, I love this cover. I think it's a beautiful cover. Here's Ninjak number six. Here's Ninjak number 12. Here's Ninjak number 13. This should be, this is number 13. And here's Ninjak number 24, and this cover is beautiful. And these look to be in near mint condition, near mint minus, near mint condition. Nice copy. So that's the Ninjak. That's from the relaunch. That's the only thing we got from the relaunch other than the reprint of the Masters set. Now, as far as I'm concerned, the main reason, aside from grabbing Harbinger number four and five, okay, the main reason I put the offer for these is the Rye Comics. So let me show you this. Let me pull up the haul again. I gotta take these tapes off again. Take a look. These are some of the sought-after books from the 1990s. They would fetch the most insane prices. Right, people were chasing these hard. Hard. Very happy to get these. So, this lot is, let me take a look at this. This lot is the last one that you see in the table, okay? And it's Rye number two, Rye number four, and Archer and Armstrong number zero, right? Now, what you don't see in there, it's actually three copies of Archer and Armstrong number zero, two copies of Rye Number 2 and one copy of Rye Number 4, right? And just to give you an appreciation for this, let me, where's the other guy? Did he double? Yeah, he doubled it. Okay, cool. So let me show you this. Let me pull down this hall. Okay, let me give you, show you the rarest valiants. If you see the rarest valiants up there, there's Rye Number 3, Rye Number 4, Rye Number 5, Rye Number 2. Okay. And two of them are in here. We're going to take a look at. Okay. So here is Rye Number 2. I'm not going to take them out of the bags. They look like to be in great, great shape. Really. They look fantastic. Sure. Like these are nines. 9.2. So, anyway. Rye Number 2. They're cheap on eBay right now. Okay. Important books. And if you like sci-fi, this is fantastic sci-fi. This is Rye Number 2 again. Okay. So two copies of Rye Number 2. Here's Rye Number 4. You can put a backing board on this one, but this one's great shape as well. Here's Rye Number 4. Beautiful cover. Fantastic sci-fi. Fantastic sci-fi. Okay. I loved Rye. Harbinger was fantastic. Here's the back of it. I'm doing this whole video with my glasses on because I'm looking at the comic books trying to figure out what grade they're in amazing shape. Really. Oh, the back cover, what is this? Wizards and Warriors 3. They like Rye Number 4. This was very hard to find back in the 90s. This was fetching anywhere between, when Valiant took off, was fetching anywhere between 40, 50, 60, $80 for this, right? In the early 1990s. Tack on inflation for this. You'll see what we're talking about, right? And here's Archer and Armstrong number zero. First appearance of Archer and Armstrong. This series is absolutely amazing. So good. So good. Here's two and here's three copies of Archer and Armstrong number zero. And again, this is cover by Barry Windsor Smith. And the internal work for this is Barry Windsor Smith as well, the pencils, and I believe the inks as well. Okay. First appearance of Archer and Armstrong. And these look like to be fantastic condition. Fantastic condition. Awesome seller. Very nice. Very nice. What, how much did we pay for that? We paid, he listed these. Here, let me bring up the table again. He listed these, the hall. Doink. Take a look. He listed this lot for $29.55 Canadian. I offered him 20, 32% less than what he was asking for. Yeah, I'm very happy with this. Okay, $20 Canadian is $15, $16 US, is it? 75 cents, 0.7, yeah. So $15, $16 US. Okay, and Archer and Armstrong is fantastic, really. And if you've been following my YouTube videos, the videos, the comic book videos, you'll know that the 2012 Archer and Armstrong series with both, with Archer and Armstrong. Archer is this guy, the little guy. Armstrong is the big guy, and he's the Eternal Warrior's brother and Ivar's brother. The 2012 Archer and Armstrong series is one of the greatest comic book series ever printed, right? From the relaunch, and there's 25 issues in that. So if you want to have a nice humor read, the 2012 Archer and Armstrong series is fantastic. Fantastic. Okay. And those look to be great shape. And I'll, while we have the table up, I'll show you this one as well. You know, we'll talk about this one. The last lot I bought off this guy is the second one down the table. Right? Oop, let's do it here. The second one down the table. And again, it's Rye Comics. Okay. And it's Rye Number 2, 3, 4, 5. And the kicker, 29, 30, 31, 32, and 33. And if you remember this chart, let me bring out the chart. Boop. Percentages in the chart. Let me take down the hall. So number 29, for number 29, 30, 31, 32, and 33 is towards the tail end of the graph, right? It's the last issue. Number 30 is the last issue of Rye. So they had low print runs, lower anyway. They're one of the higher print runs of the last comic books that Valiant was printing, but still low relative to a lot of other comic books, right? So we got the front end of Rye when it first got released, and Rye, I believe, was the second, is the and just so you know, Rye is the first original Valiant hero that Valiant Comics created. So I have a, we've read Rye, a Magnus Robot Fighter number 5, and it's the first appearance of Rye, right? So we've read it, and I have a huge fondness for Rye. So it's the first Valiant original comic book character, like hero. I'm pretty sure they've created some random ones, but the first comics that they released were, and that's the other reason I got my glasses on, because I used the knife to cut through this, so I don't want to do any damage to these. And how much did we pay for this? Let me bring out the lot again. Let me take down the chart. Oh, let me take down the chart and this. And just so you know, and he was asking 35 for this lot, and I offered him 25, and he accepted. Whew. Freedom for the comics. Should we crack open one of the Rye? And by the way, well, you'll see how many Rye's in here. There was two copies of Rye number 2 in the other lot. There's two copies of Rye number 2 in this lot as well, right? So with this haul, we ended up grabbing four copies of Rye number 2. And this lot has Rye number 3, and it has Rye number 4 and 5 in there as well, right? So if you take a look at the rarest pre-Unity, let me take down the haul again. Doop. Put up the rarest pre-Unity Valiants. Well, we got the top four rarest pre-Unity Valiants in this haul. Rye number 2. Let me take down the chart for those that are watching it, right? So we got the top four, and we had Harbinger number 4 in there with the number 5, right? The fifth rarest. But the top four rarest Valiant comics, pre-Unity Valiant comics, we got right here. So here's Rye number 2 again. Okay, I'll show you the inside pages of Rye number 2. Rye number 2. Here's Rye number 2 again. Okay. Here's Rye number 3. I love this cover. This is one of the my favorite Valiant covers ever. It is absolutely beautiful, right? And what you'll notice with all the Valiant covers, pre-Unity Valiant covers, there's no text on them. It was just artwork. They didn't have any words on the covers, right? Where a lot of the other publishers were putting big words, "buy me" and "big surprise" and "big reveal" and just look crazy messy. Valiant was just this. Look at that cover. Beautiful. And Rye, the name R-A-Y-R-A-I, is short for samurai, right? And it's Japan in 4001 AD in the future on a floating island around Earth. It's beautiful, beautiful sci-fi. Nothing else like it. Here's number 4. Beautiful cover. You've seen this one already. And here's number 5. I really like the cover of Rye number 5 as well. I think it's beautiful. Absolutely fantastic. Right. And here are the later issues of Rye. Oh, he's got them back to back. I wish he backed and boarded each one individually. But he's definitely going to get a phenomenal feedback. Right. This one's even got a price tag on it. Take a look at this. This is Rye number 30. Okay. And I believe he's doubled it. So let me see what the inside of here is. Let's put the tape here. Come on. So this is Rye number 30. Take a look. Nice cover. Here's Rye number 29. What condition is this in? I would give this one about a 7.5. It's got some scuff marks up top. Okay, but I don't have these. I'm happy to have them. Let's put these guys here. Take a look at the other two. Right. Here it is. Got three? It's got two in here. Let's take a look. Here's number 33. This is the last issue, I believe. This looks like to be in really good shape. Here's number 33. What kind of condition is that? This was beautiful condition. Okay, let's put that guy there. Here's number 32. Bad penny, part 2 of 2. Nice, nice, nice. Here is number 31. Look at that. Look at that. That's number 31. Okay. So that is our comic book haul. All Valiants. And if we pop this up again, right, for those watching live, we'll show it up again at this table, right? We ended up getting 51 books, right? He had them listed for $166.50, ended up picking up for $112 Canadian, right? Which was basically on average 33% less than what he was asking for. That was $112 Canadian is $84 US, so that's what we ended up picking up for. He charged $30 shipping, right? Packaging and stuff, which is legit. That's what it costs now, it's expensive, right? So it came out total of $142 Canadian, which is $107 US. All of these lots together, most of them backed and boarded, including shipping, $107, 51 books, and basically ended up costing $2.10 per unit, and he was asking $2.90 per unit, right, if you think about it per unit, but per unit, doesn't play out as well in this type of haul because there were some valuable comics in here, rare comics, and there's some more common comics in this, right? And that's one thing I wanted to do with this comic book haul was basically present you guys with the data, with the print runs, with, you know, this is the comic book haul, and here, let me show you the print runs for the comics we ended up getting, right? The comics we ended up getting, so the comics we ended up getting, you know, Archer and Armstrong, if you look down at the table there, Archer and Armstrong number 0 that we got 3 copies for, those had 100,000 print run, right? Which was a lot for that time for Valiant Comics. That's when they were really slowly starting to pick up. That was still pre-Unity, by the way. Archer and Armstrong number 0 was still pre-Unity. It's the first appearance of Archer Armstrong, and then Archer Armstrong number one and two were the Unity crossover. They overlap with them, right? So from this, you can see what we ended up picking up, the key issues anyway, except for Harbinger number 14 and 15, they have a higher print run, and Harbinger number 11 has a higher print run. But most of these things are, you know, less than 40, less than 60,000, I guess, with Solar number one and four, right? But there's a lot here that are 40,000 print run, 30,000 print run, some that are only 17,000 print run, right? So theoretically, if all 17,000 of Solar number 59 exist, and Solar 60 has less of a print run, I think there's maybe 12,000 print run for Solar number 60, then only 12,000 completed runs of Solar from the 1990s can ever be put together, right? And just to, you know, expand on this a little bit more, because we're talking about comic books, and we're going to link this up with ASMR math and investing in general, personal finance, right? A while ago, what I ended up doing, we did another comic book haul, which was basically, it was an ASMR math video that we linked up with a comic book haul that we did, right? There are a lot of Golden Age and Silver Age comic books that we had. It was a great haul, that haul, right? But what we ended up doing for that, I basically put out a video saying introduction to investing in comic books, a primer and two spreadsheets. And we did a, you know, a fairly long video where we talked about what it means to invest in something and how we could take a look at some of the data of what we are investing in, right? So we put together a couple of tables, and the links for those tables are in the video that we put out, and they're sort of common space tables that you can edit and whatnot, or copy and use, whatever, right? And in that table, we had some print runs, and we talked about some of the metrics we could look at when it comes to investing in any type of art form or anything that you want to invest in, right? So what I did was take a look at some more data, and not just related to print runs, but selling price of certain comics, okay? And I put together a table, okay, and a chart that I want to show you right now. And this table, the comics that we're going to talk about, these are two comics that we've already done the reading for. One of them is Harbinger number one, right? And we did a reading for Harbinger number one, as well as that was, you know, Harbinger that came out in the 1990s, the first original Valiant comic book series ever put out, right? And we did a reading for Book of Death, Fall of Harbinger, which was in the relaunch of Valiant Comics, right? So we've done a couple of readings of Harbinger. Harbinger number one, I'm going to show you the data for. And we also did a reading of the first appearance of Bloodshot with Rye number zero, as well as the first cameo appearance of Etern of Bloodshot, which was in an Eternal Warrior number four. So what I'm about to do is show you the data, what price Harbinger number one graded, CGC graded, but this is basically graded, slabbed, graded at 9.4, has been selling for since from 2002 to 2018. And what Eternal Warrior number four that we did the reading for, graded at 9.8, has been selling for from 2005 to 2018 from the website that I collected the data from, right? And I'll have links in the description of this video. So here's the table, okay? That's the table. And here's the graph, if you're gonna take a look at this, right? And let me take this guy down. If you want to know what it means, what you should look at when it comes to investing, and some of the metrics that we can look at, and we will look at this further, right? If you graph what Harbinger number one CGC graded, or there's two other companies that are grading comic books as well. One of them is very highly ranked. I would put them in the same category as CGC, right? Another one doesn't fetch as much as premium price, right? So basically, think about it as Harbinger number one, graded by a third party at 9.4, in 2002 was selling for $45, right? 2003 to 2009, 10, 11 was selling for around 40, 50, 30. There's, some sales at 70, and they have the frequency of these sales as well, right? The frequency is basically how many of something has occurred, right? We have the frequency, there's a chart where you could think about the how many issues of a comic print were printed as frequency as well, right? But these are sales that were done, right? So there was some amount of data available from 2002 to 2011. Harbinger number one, graded 9.4, was selling anywhere between 30 to 50, $60, right? And then in 2012, it started kicking up a little bit. It had a bounce up, right? And the blue graph, the blue line there, I believe is the blue line. I should look at my own chart right here. The blue line there is Harbinger number one, right? So it had a little bump up in 2012 because Valiant Comics was coming on again, and they did a relaunch with Harbinger number one, right? And then it started coming down in 2014 again. It was selling for around 40, $50, right? And then it started kicking up. And right now, 9.4 is selling for around $200, right? Sometimes it goes for 150, sometimes it goes for 250, and it's kicking up, edging up, right? And I used 9.4 graded data was because that was the one that was m longest amount of data, most amount of frequency, most amount of data that I could use, right? 9.8 Harbinger number one graded is selling for over $1,000. If you look back at the data and it's available on that site, 9.8 Harbinger number one was selling for less than $100 in 2002, 2003, from what I remember, okay? And if we take a look at Eternal Warrior number four, in 2005, from 2005 to 2011, it was selling anywhere between $20 to $40, right? This is graded at 9.8, by the way, higher grade. I used the 9.8 because there was more of this data available, okay? It had a higher frequency, and I liked more data better than less data, okay? So I didn't pick Eternal Warrior 9.4, I picked the 9.8, okay? And then again, it had a bump up in 2013. It was sold for $102, and then 2014 it came down to 49. Now, Eternal Warrior number four, because Valiant Comics has come out and said that, they're doing more Bloodshot comics, and they've said they've partnered up with Sony Pictures that they're going to release Harbinger and Bloodshot movies, right? And they just announced Faith and stuff like this. So there's media, movies, and other things coming on with Valiant Comics. Right now, 2014 was selling for $50. In 2018, selling for over $200. Eternal Warrior number four, graded at 9.8, right? And this is this type of data we can take a look at, and we can use some metrics and do some analysis. And this type of analysis will also apply to anything else that you want to invest in, that you want to take a look at, right? So we're definitely going to link up all of this stuff with ASMR math and personal finance and all that jazz. And this is some of the data I wanted to present in this comic book haul. That's why it took me a few days to put it all together and seek out the data and, take a look at the information and find the info online. It was hard to find, right? But we will definitely expand on this a lot more. And again, in that video, we talked about, that we did for ASMR Math, the primer to investing in comic books. We talked a little bit about, what we could do with the data, and we took a look at some print runs of some other comic books that we had in that haul, right? Or some of the comic books that I grabbed some data from online, right? We looked at what the lowest print run for Batman Comics is and Detective Comics is that occurred in the 1980s, but they're very cheap, right? They had like 35, 40,000 print runs for Batman and Detective Comics. Now, if I was collecting, investing, I would put a little bit of money in that as well, because they're the rarest Batman Detective Comics. And at some point, when people decide to collect complete runs, they might need those issues, right? And those things are going for the cheap, 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 cheap dollar bin stuff you can find most likely, right? So that's about it. That's our comic haul. And just so you know, since we're comic hauls, I have another comic haul coming. Hopefully it'll be here next week. So we're gonna do another comic book haul video as soon as I get that lot, okay? And we won't, you know, look into the data and you know, too much into the print runs and stuff, but we'll definitely do a comic book haul video, just straight up comic book haul video, okay? With that haul when it comes, and that next comic book haul, you know, I put the offers in for this lot, and I left a little buffer for myself just in case the person rejected them. I would just buy out most of the lots straight out, or with a counter offer, I would take the counter offer and buy them. So I had a little bit of funds in my comic book budget. But what basically happened was, when I was editing the cryptocurrency video, that is the previous video, I think after the announcement, previous to the announcement video for this on YouTube that we put on. When I was editing that video, I needed a little break. So, you know, I stopped editing and went online and checked my messages. And the first message there was someone mentioning that, you know, they loved what I did, you know, what I'm producing. And they wanted to contribute, they wanted to support my work, right? And this is the message I opened up. So I'm going to read this to you, right? Hey Chicho, I've been following your YouTube channel for years now, and I want and I'm grateful for it. I'm excited to make a donation to you, but or it'll be a hold on, but oh no, I didn't get the whole thing. Want and I'm grateful for it, and I want and I'm grateful for it. Oh no, I didn't print off the whole thing, it cut it off a little bit. Let me check it out. I'll be dropping the bucket. Oh, sorry guys, I can't read you the whole thing because I printed this off, but my printer's all wacko, so it didn't print off the whole thing. But basically, in that email, he basically said he wanted to make a donation, and he had a little bit of funds put away to support my work. And he said he would make the donation on one stipulation, that if I use the money to buy comic books. And I was eyeing some other lots that I wanted to buy. There's a couple of them by the time I got there, by the time he sent the donation, and he sent more than what I was expecting. But thank you very much for the donation, by the way, for the support. You're gonna love the haul coming in. It has Valiant in it as well. It has something else in it as well. Okay, it was something that I was looking at, very happy to get, really very happy to get. So thank you for that. So the donation came in, and when it came in, there was a couple of some lots I was looking at, and there was one that was buy it now. I made an offer, but then I didn't wait for the person to reply for my offer. I just went back to it and just went buy it now, right? Because I wanted that lot. And another comic, it was from a different buyer. He had two lots up, so I bought one just straight out. He would have taken my offer, but I wasn't gonna take the risk. And the other one, I made him an offer, and he took that offer. So that we'll probably take a look at in next week, hopefully when it gets here. As soon as it gets here, we'll take a look at it. Okay, we're not gonna sit on that one. So that's about it. I hope you enjoyed this haul. I loved it. Very happy. I have all the pre-Unity stuff in my collection already, but happy to have them. I will definitely, and they're buried, but I'm definitely going to read through some of these again. And I'm very happy to have the later issues of the Valiants that came in the 1990s, right? Thank you very much for sticking around. I hope you enjoyed, and I hope everyone on the live stream had a good time watching this comic haul. Okay, that's it for now. I'll see you guys in the next video. Oof, my throat's going raw a little bit. I gotta do a little sip of tea. So guys, I'm gonna stop the recording. This guy, I'm gonna stop the sound. And I gotta make sure, I wanna see where the battery is on this, because I think I need to change the battery on this recorder. Yeah. So before every time I do a live stream, or every time I do a video, I always check the battery on this thing. So if it goes down one bar, I change the battery because you don't want the battery to run out halfway through a shoot, right? I've had it happen to me before. So let me do a little adjustment and we'll come back to the live stream and I'm going to read some comments because there's a whole bunch of comments there. And if there's anything you guys want to talk about, we'll do a little talk. Let me take this off too so I don't get tangled. This guy out of the way. Let's bring these comic books out of the way. And change the camera angle. Nice. Let's break this here. Okay, let me put on my glasses. Nice. How's everyone doing? Let's check this out. Okay, I'm gonna read Elvis. Oh, we read Elvis. Clap, clap. Good afternoon, Chicho. Good afternoon, Zare. How are you doing? We just commenting on YouTube. You're on there. He isn't replying to the chat at the moment. He'll talk after the video. Yeah, thank you, Fastcar. Yay, finally caught a stream. Thank you for the sleep aid and all the interesting content, especially the comment. My pleasure, Simon. My pleasure, man. Nice. Junkyard. Hey, this is first live stream on Twitch. Nice. Skinny Gray. X. Oops. Let me do this. Let me catch up. 7,000 viewer hype. 7,000. I guess we had a horde coming and bots coming or something. Nice beard. Thank you. Finally able to catch one of your streams again. How are you, brother? Doing well, Lizard. Thank you very much, man. Wilson, Wilson, how are you? Hey guys, been a minute. Hope you're all well. Dude. Did you see the Michelle Obama 8-pin heels? What? No, I don't follow the antics of those and anyway. Hi, luxurious. When did you first get into crypto? Back in 2010, 2011 or so. Mr. Banzai, I know nothing of comics, but that was interesting. And those Rye arts are beautiful. Yeah, the Rye's. It should get, Rye should get way more respect than it does. It is some of the best sci-fi I've ever come across. Absolutely magnificent sci-fi. Really love it. Really love it. Okay, let's check this out. What's our uptime? Uptime. Nice. Almost 2 hour stream. Damn, I bet you bought early into it. I bought into Bitcoin in 2000. Feels good, man. Yeah, Bitcoin, you know what? The cryptos, the cryptos is it's brilliant disruptive technology. To a certain degree, it's being hijacked. To a certain degree, it needs time to go into the system. And it's more about the blockchain than the cryptos themselves specifically right now, my opinion. But if you want, we can talk about that stuff. But I've had some requests, by the way. I'll mention this right now. And I'm going to mention an update video. The update video we're going to do on Tuesday, right? People have been asking me to talk more about politics, right? Politics. I'm trying to approach it from the realm of economics, but we've reached a point right now that you have to have a holistic view of the whole thing. You have to be able to see what's going on with everyone. So I might put up another announcement video before we do the update video, or I might do an announcement later on. But what we're going to do with in regards to politics and economics, I'm going to start doing open discussion politics, economics live streams, and we're going to have the lapel mic set up with the camcorder set up. And basically, I'm not going to go on rants. Just I'm not going to create anything where we're going to, I'm going to tell you what I think about certain situations. But open discussion, Q&A. If you guys want to talk about politics and economics, we'll talk about politics and economics, okay? But it's got to be questions coming from you, and I'll do my best to give you my take, okay? If there's anything that I think I'm not well informed enough to give you my opinion, I may just say I'm not well informed enough to give you my opinion, because there's nobody that can give you their opinion about everything that's going on in the world. So expect open discussion, politics, economics, Q&A sessions, live streams coming up. And if there's any questions that are being asked where it's been asked of me before, where I think I have a legitimate answer, something to contribute, we'll record on a lapel mic and the camcorder, and I'll edit the stuff and I'll load those on. And on that note, what we're going to do with this video that we just did, the comic book haul and the live stream, all the live streams that we're going to do from now on, where we're also recording, I'm going to tag in with behind the scenes when it's being loaded on BitChute and YouTube. So don't expect this live stream to be loaded on BitChute and YouTube tomorrow. I have to wait 24 hours to load, to load anything that we record on Twitch to other platforms. And that's what I've been doing. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to edit the videos that I shoot, load those on, and then we'll load on the live streams after the edited videos have been loaded on. And that's the format I really want to follow. Okay, I'll mention this again in future streams, but I think people will get a gist of what's happening and the way we're going to approach this. Okay. Hey Chicho, I just want to say that I love your content and happy that I could finally catch a stream of yours, which is kind of hard since I am from Germany and it's almost 3 a.m. Ah, no worries, man. Oh, 3 a.m. That's right. You guys are 9 hours ahead. I have relatives in Duisburg and Cologne. Also, a question. What is the most expensive rare comic out there? And which is the most expensive rare comic you own yourself? The most expensive would be Action Comics number one. That's the first appearance of Superman. I do for sure it's not the rarest. And Detective Comics number 27 is the first appearance of Batman. I'm assuming those are the two most expensive comic books out there. If I'm going by memory, there might be some other random, one issue ever printed or something, but I'm not privy to that information. As for me, the first appearance of Daredevil, Daredevil number one, I have. It's mid-grade copy. Fetches a few hundred bucks. I do have copies of Harbinger number one with the coupons. I have a couple of copies with the coupons. I had 10 back in, like, I was buying the stuff off the shelf, by the way, when it comes to Valiant Comics. No one was buying them, right? When they came on the shelf, I read these things. I went, wow, what is this? What an amazing company. So I bought multiple copies of the comics they were putting out, multiple copies of, I started with Magnus number one, Solar number one, and bought multiple copies of one, two, three, four, five. It was just amazing. And when Harbinger number one hit, I bought multiple copies, right? Back then in the 90s, I sold a lot of them. Okay. I wish I didn't sold Harbinger number ones, right? Because at the time, I was selling the Harbinger number ones for $100, right? And they were beautiful copies, 9.8s, right? I kept two or three of them. Okay. And I had a Harbinger number zero, beautiful copies, right? Right now, Harbinger number one, graded 9.8, is selling for over $1,000. Okay, so somehow, someone's driving a Harley outside, you could hear it, right? Daredevil number one, first appearance of Daredevil came out in the 1960s. The copy I have is probably less than $1,000. Harbinger number one that came out in 1992, 1992, 1991, 1992, I believe, right? It's selling for over $1,000. So it's hard to tell, you know, what is the most expensive. It really depends on liquidity, something we've talked about in economics, personal finance. It really depends on liquidity. Harbinger number one is not as liquid as Daredevil number one. So in good times, something that's not as liquid, you know, if people have a lot of money, which is happening right now, low interest rates, economies flooded with money, not to me and you, but to those that have connections, right? So they're taking money that is very cheap, devalued, and they're putting it into assets. But if that tightens up, then things that are not as important, they drop in price. Things are, I wouldn't say Harbinger number one is not as important as Daredevil number one, but it hasn't been around as long. And Daredevil number one will keep a higher percent of its value. It's like blue chip stock versus this type of stock, this type of company versus that type of company. So it's hard to tell, brother. It's hard to tell. Germany, your football team will be coming home soon, won't they? I'm pretty sure Germany's football team is already home. Only joking, dude. It's unfortunate they got knocked out, but they're a young team, man. I watched two of Germany's games, and one of them they did phenomenal. That team is going to get stronger and stronger. Don't write off Germany. And the two games today, fantastic games. Argentina and France and Uruguay and Portugal. Uruguay is looking powerful, powerful, powerful. As far as I'm concerned, France and Uruguay are the two most powerful teams right now, and they're meeting in the next round. Everyone should watch that game. I don't know who's gonna win. I just want a brilliant game. I love football. I love soccer. I spent a month in 1994 in the World Cup in California watching. I went to the final of the World Cup as well, so I was lucky enough to do that. Thank you for your detailed answer. My pleasure, brother. That's the thing. When it comes to investing, you know, I keep this in mind. Nothing I say is personal financial advice, right? Investing is very personal. Some people give value to certain things that other people don't give value to, and vice versa, right? When it comes to personal finance investing, you have to think about your budget, your expenses, what you care about, what you want to invest your time and energy on. Some people only chase money. If one thing I would recommend is don't do that. Don't just chase money. Incorporate what you love into your lifestyle and make it a, if you can, make it a revenue stream for yourself, or an entertainment stream for yourself, or a pastime stream for yourself. So it's not just you taking money, putting it in a safe, closing it. It's you incorporating your investment into your life, and that'll bring you happiness, and that will make life, your experience here, absolutely beautiful. That's what I've learned in my years of doing a few things. And hopefully my experience, my knowledge will grow over time, because that's what I found out. Right now, I think back 10 years and I think I was stupid. I think back 20 years, I find I was an idiot, right? Hopefully 20 years from now, I'll look back. I won't think I was stupid or an idiot. Hopefully I'll think that I had a lot to learn, and I would have learned it by that time, if we make it that far, right? Football's coming home to England. Football, we're certain of it in the UK until we get knocked out in the semis. UK is playing really well, man. UK is playing really well. I watched two of their games as well. I've been watching a lot of games. I've been watching a lot of games. I have some collectibles, some things, memorabilia. I can't even pronounce it, from 1994 World Cup. I might make a video showing you guys that. I'm not gonna make it during the World Cup season right now. It'd have to be at another date, because I have my tickets. I still have my tickets that in the World Cup, that I went to see the World Cup in 94, right? I have my semi-final ticket, final ticket, quarter-final ticket. all that jazz, right? But I have some other stuff I could show you. They're important to me. And I used to record every World Cup game from 1980s all the way to 2000 and whatever it was, right? 2002, I believe, was the last one. So that's about it. That was our comic book haul. We've been streaming nicely. A couple of hours stream. That was good. So the next stream we're gonna do is on Tuesday. I forget what time it is. I think it's at 2 o'clock or something. And it's gonna be an update video. So I'm gonna spend the next few days putting together my thoughts and think of it as a, shareholder meeting. I'm gonna again record it, lapel mic, this. And if there's any, we'll do a meet and greet at the beginning. Cooking stream. Cooking stream will be coming up. There's a few things I need to knock off before we get into the cooking stream. My computer's been giving me a little bit of problems in the last month. It's crashed on me three or more than that, five or six times. And it's last couple of days I found that there's some driver issues that it's doing. The error hasn't come up again yet. It happens when I'm doing certain things. And for the cooking stream, I have three cameras going. So I'll try it out, but cooking stream for sure coming up. There's lots of things I'm going to show you when it comes to cooking, and hopefully we'll make jam again real time this time, right? Video card issues probably then. Hopefully not. I've mentioned this before. I've mentioned in the upstream in the update video as well. If I had to do it all over again, buying all this equipment, this laptop cost me 2 grand, right? I would have spent 4 grand and doubled it up. Right, I would have bought a more expensive laptop. Okay, but we'll do what we can with the setup right now. And once I get more funds and whatever, more revenue streams coming in, more support. If once I build up my bank, I'll upgrade again. Okay, hopefully sooner rather than later. We'll see. The master of all things chill. Is this the end? Did I miss it? This is the end, brother. We've been doing it in 2 hours. Wait, what? Damn. Should have bought a desktop, to be honest. They're more, yeah, for sure. I have a desktop that I love, that I do all my video editing on that. It's slow, the processing, but because I'm moving around, right? I'm doing different setups, going to the kitchen, doing live streams with students, doing math live streams. I'm moving things around a lot. It just didn't seem legit to me to do a desktop. And I'm mobile as well. I want to be able to live stream in a couple of different places. That's the reason I bought the laptop. But 100% desktop, you get way more bang for your buck, way more bang for your buck. And I think what I might do is for the next one, just use this laptop for any mobile live streams we're going to do. And maybe I'll buy a desktop and just move my desktop around and set it up. And that way we'll just do desktop in-house and mobile not in-house. But I did need a mobile because I am moving around, so that's what I decided to do. I bought a gaming laptop. Okay, but we'll figure it out. This was my first venture into live streaming, right? I didn't know what to expect. It was a serious learning curve, right? Well worth it though, well worth it. Well, if it's $2,000, then yeah, it's probably just your video drivers, which shouldn't be much of an issue. Okay. Yeah, maybe, most likely, but we'll see. We'll see. It has been during the times where I'm doing multiple things on the laptop, so I'm gonna try to stop that. Not push the laptop as far as I push my desktop. Okay. Thank you for popping by, guys. I hope you like the comic books. I'm gonna go grab some bags and boards and bag and board these babies and box them and keep some out to read. I want to read some of these babies. Hey Chicho, what's your plan with the comic book readings? Are you going to live stream any, or are you moving on from the? Oh no, we're definitely going to be doing comic book readings. That my pleasure, man. Just regarding the comic book readings, we're going to do the same type of setup that we did for how to study, how to take notes, where I had the tripod set up with two different cameras. So what we're going to do with the comic book readings, 100% we're going to do more. I know people have been asking me, and my apologies for not getting to them faster, but I really needed the time to learn how to live stream, right? So what we're going to do, we're going to set up the same way we set up the how to study video, And there, the how to study and the behind the scenes of how to study is up as well. Okay, so we're gonna do the same setup. We're gonna most likely live stream some of them as well as record them at the same time. And there's some that we're just gonna, I'm just gonna record on DVD on the HD camera with a lapel mic. So comic book readings are coming, man. One person that asked me, I mentioned, expect them in August. I might try to get a couple in because people have been asking me. I might try to get a couple in before August. But in August, I plan on sitting down for 2 to 3 weeks and doing a whole bunch in a row. Some live stream, all of them recorded, and some just recording and editing. There's a lot of editing involved with that stuff, and I've been trying to give myself a little break with the editing, but we're getting back into it. So they will be coming. They will be coming. If it doesn't work out, just try different streaming programs. If you're using UBS, use Streamlabs, OBS. I'm using OBS. XSplit, I haven't used XSplit. Any chance you would do a video talking about Axis and Allies? You seem to have some serious passion for sure. Axis Analyze is on my list to do. We will do gaming videos during the summer. One of them will be Axis and Allies. As soon as I need to get one more game in with my gaming group, but right now for the summer, my gaming group is sort of split out and stuff like this. But I might try to get a game in, hook up with them in July. If not in July, we're gonna try to maybe hook up in August, okay? And as soon as we hook up one more time, play one more night of Axis and Allies, I'll do a live stream telling you guys how we play that. Nice. You're catching the end of a live stream, brother. You're catching the end of it. End of a 2 hour plus live stream. But we're gonna do another one on Tuesday, okay? So, with that, gang, I'll see you guys on Tuesday if you can make it, and I'll do more announcement videos and set up schedule live streams as well as just popping in randomly and just doing a meet and greet or just doing maybe behind the scenes shooting a video and doing a live stream introduction and then recording at the same time again. Okay. Aside from that, hope you have a great weekend. And if you're watching the games, I hope your team makes it through and you enjoy the games. Talk to you guys later. Bye for now.